Today's lecture we shall be starting with the color models, and this is the very essential part of computer graphics. The reason being, colors make or mar the beauty of a presentation. If you have added colors to your presentation, to your drawing, to your object, it will give you a real-time aesthetic appeal. So, in this particular topic, we shall be, because this is an introductory lecture into colors, so we shall be discussing regarding how color is formed, what is color, and basic definition of all the major components, and we'll talk about, say, electromagnetic radiations, and then the visible spectrum. So, briefly we shall describe. And we already know that the color, if we add color, there are in the objects that are moving, that are, it will give you a real time effect to the person who is viewing it. So let us start with this. The fundamental topics that we shall be covering here is color fundamentals, chromaticity diagram, and color models. Let us start with the first slide. The first slide itself is about what is color and the essential elements. To see color, three essential elements must be present, that is light and illuminated object and the observer. So if you will find that sun is a source of light, and it is the sun rays are falling onto the object, and then from the object the light is being transmitted to the eye, where the picture is formed in the retina, and then the observer is able to see a particular object in that particular color. So, as mentioned here, there are three things: light, illuminated object, and the observer are the three basic things which are required here. Now, if you observe this particular slide, we will find that the electromagnetic light is an electromagnetic energy, and it has a range of 400 to 700 nanometers. And in the visible spectrum, this particular spectrum is there. We can find out that there are various components of this particular spectrum, but we form the visible spectrum here within this range, and this is around about 400 to 700 nanometers. 700 nanometers this side and 400 nanometers this side. So we have a wavelength that is measured in this particular top. Now, if you see here, visible light is an electromagnetic wave in the range 400 to 700 nanometers, and amplitude is measured in lambda. Then wavelength, that is wavelength on the x-axis, we can see there violet light, and this is the red light in the case of WebGuild. WebGuild is violet indigo, that particular thing we write with G-Y-O-R. With your violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, and red. That is why the starting one is violet, and the last one there is the red. And within 400 nanometer, this one, and this is 700 nanometers, the last one. So we can see here the visible light. Now, this particular thing, that is the white light, the color spectrum. Spectrum shows the range of wavelength of energy that are visible to the human eye. Variations in the wavelengths alter the colors. Now, different wavelengths are there, and if all the wavelengths are present, it becomes white light, but if a particular wavelength is dominating, that becomes the color of that particular object. So, we have here Isaac Newton's showed. With his prisms, white light is a mixture of all the colors of the visible spectrum. The frequency or the mix of frequencies of the light determine the color. The frequency or the mix of frequencies of the light determines the color. The amount of light, sheer quantity of photons, is the intensity. That is the amount of light is the intensity. Sheer quantity of photons, how many photons are there, that will count about the intensity of that particular light. Now, frequency is a mix of frequency, light determines the color. Three independent quantities that describe any color are hue, saturation, and lightness or brightness or intensity. So, So here we have to note down these three components. This is the first component, second component, and this is the third component. So hue, saturation, lightness or brightness or intensity. The hue is determined by the dominant wavelength, that is the apparent color of the light. Now here this hue, this particular thing, that is the first thing, it determines the dominant wavelength. For example, if we have a red as the more dominant wavelength here in particular object, so that is called as a hue. So hue in that case will be red, red color. So when we call a red, we are referring to its hue. Hue is determined by the dominant wavelength. That is dominant wavelength in a particular color, that will determine what type of color will be visible to the people. So here, next slide. Light and color, they are three. Next one is the saturation. And saturation of a color ranges from neutral to brilliant. And the circle on the right is more vivid red than the circle on the left hand side. You can see here. Although both have the same hue. Both of them have the same hue. The saturation of the color ranges from neutral to brilliant. The circle on the right hand side, if you see here, both of them are of the same hue, that is the red color is there, but the saturation level is very very high here, like less here. The saturation is determined by the excitation purity and depends upon the amount of white light mixed with that particular hue. Amount of white light that is mixed with that particular hue. Pure hue is fully saturated with no white light. Mixed in hue and saturation together determine the chromaticity of the given color. This is the most important point here, chromaticity of that particular color. It is determined by and combination of hue and the saturation value, that is by hue and saturation, and they are mixed together, and hue and saturation mixed together determines the chromaticity of that particular given color. So then this is the second thing. The first thing is hue, which determines the color, and that is the dominant wavelength in that particular object. And second one is the saturation. Now in the case of saturation, this is least saturated and the most saturated, though the hue is same. Which hue? The hue here in this particular case is the red color. Now in the next slide, this is the third component, the lightness or intensity values of that particular thing. Lightness or brightness refers to the amount of light color reflects or transmits. Finally, the intensity is determined by the actual amount of light with more light corresponding to more intense colors. Total light across all frequencies. Total light across all frequencies. Finally, intensity is determined by the actual amount of color light. With more light corresponding to more intense colors, that is intensity is measured here. Now next thing, the color of light is characterized by three things: hue, saturation and lightness. Hue is the dominant frequency, highest peak, and saturation is the excitation purity, that is the ratio of the highest to the rest. Lightness is the luminance area in the curve. We have already discussed the chromaticity is determined, and the previous slide we have seen the saturation is determined by the saturation purity, and white lights mixing hue and saturation together are called as chromaticity as seen here, and then we have discussed this. In this particular case, now it is the dominant frequency. Now this is the saturation, that is it is amount of hue mixed in the white light, therefore it is the saturation level. And then this is the lightness or the intensity, luminance area under the curve. This is the area under the curve. Then we have here, this is the pure white light, and this is red, this is violet, frequency and energy is being shown here. Orange light, for example, if we see here, this is red, this is violet, and within this energy level, this is the mentioned here, this particular thing. So here, light has dominant frequency, set of frequencies called as chromatic. Light that has a dominant frequency or set of frequencies is called as chromatic, because suppose any object which has got color, or chrome. Chrome generally is used. Chrome here refers to the frequency of that particular color. Now in this particular case, chromatic light has no color. Chromatic light has no color. Its only attribute is quantity or intensity. Its only attribute is quantity or intensity. Now, achromatic light has no color, but chromaticity, if we say something is chromatic, it has got a color value. Now, the gray level is a measure of intensity. The intensity is determined by the energy and is therefore a physical quantity. On the other hand, brightness is determined by the perception of the color and therefore is a psychological phenomenon. Given equally intense blue and green, the blue is perceived as much darker than the green. Note that our perception of intensity is non-linear with the changes of normalized intensity from 0.1 to 0.11 and from 0.5 to 0.55 being perceived as equal changes in the brightness. So, we have divided this thing into two parts. One is chromatic and another one is the achromatic. Achromatic means no color. And chromatic means some component of the frequency of visible spectrum is available in that particular mixture of colors. The intensity is determined by the energy. So, you have to note down this particular thing that intensity is a quantity that is measured with the help of energy and therefore physical quantity. It's a physical measurable quantity, intensity. And on the other hand, brightness is a psychological phenomenon. Something is bright or something is dull, that is a psychological phenomenon. And given equally intense blue and green color, now how do we perceive blue and if the intensity of the blue color and the red color is the same? So blue color will appear to be more darker as compared to the green color. Now in the next slide, the color depends primarily on the reflectance properties of an object. That is the most important point here. You have to note down, color depends upon the reflectance properties of an object. We see those rays that are reflected while others are absorbed. Some of the components are absorbed, some of them are not, and some of them are reflected. However, we also must consider the color of the light source, the nature of human visual system. For example, an object that reflects both red and green will appear green when there is green but no red light illuminating it. And conversely, it will appear red in the absence of green light. In pure white light, it will appear as yellow because the sum of red and green will give you yellow. Now, light and color. Light is falling, and you can see in this particular diagram, light is falling on a particular object and it is being reflected. Some of it is being transmitted and some of it is being absorbed here. You can see this is the phenomena which we have already studied in previous classes, but here we are just trying to demonstrate what we are going to portray, that a light is falling on this particular object. Some of it is reflected, some of it is transmitted, and some of it is absorbed. When the light size on an object, wavelengths may be reflected, absorbed, or transmitted. Colorants can be mixed to control the wavelengths and colors we see. Now let us see the eye structure here, and this is most essential part, how the image is being formed, and let us see. In this particular diagram, you will see that this is the diagram for human eye, and it is post photosensory part of the eye is called the retina, and this is the lens of the retina, and retina is largely composed of two types of cells. We have rods and cones. Rods and cones here. This is the first and second one. Rods and cones. Only the cones are responsible for the color reception, because there are two types of receptors in the eye. We have written here the rods and cones. And the color is the color phenomena is, in the eye is responsible. Will be taken care of by the cones. You can see here optical nerve connecting to brain, and central fovea. This is central fovea, and this is your retina, and we have here vitreous humor. This is the liquid that is there inside the eye, sclera, and These are all the parts of the eye, just for information sake. And now next thing, the light waves that reach the eyes stimulate the visual process so complex it is not yet fully understood within the retina. Cones respond to the color hues and brightness. The rods sense only brightness. Three types of cones respond to wavelengths in waves that produce all the colors we see. The cones are sensitive to colored light, and the rods are sensitive to achromatic light, that is the intensity only. So here we can see the next thing, that is fovea. The cones are most densely packed within the region of the eye called. Cones are packed most densely in the region of the eye called fovea. Now horizontal cells, bipolar cells. So we have here this thing. Now we have primary colors. These are three primary colors, R, G and B, that is red, green and blue. The response of each type of cone as a function of the wavelength of incident light is shown in the figure. The peaks for each curve are at 440 nanometers for blue. We can find it here, and this is 440 around out. This is the highest point. And for this one, this is the highest point. Yes. You will find that for blue color it is 440 nanometers and 545 nanometers. This is for your green, and for red color it is 580 nanometers. So this is the response to the eye. That is the cones. Note that last two actually peak in the yellow part of the spectrum. Spectral response curves for each cone. The peaks for each curve are at 440, that is blue, 545 at green, and 580 as nanometers for red. The color signal to the brain comes from the response of the three cones to the spectra being observed. That is, the signal consists of three numbers, R, G and B. A color can be specified as the sum of the three colors, so color from three dimensional vector space. These three hues, red, green and blue, are called as the primary colors. The reason being, when we add the colors in different proportions, we will be able to get different types of color combinations generated. Now the standard observer. Based upon the psychophysical measurements, standard curves have been adopted by CIE, Commission International, it's a French organization, and as the sensitivity curves for the typical observer for three pigments. They are not the actual pigment observations that we see here, absorption characteristics found in the standard human retina, but rather sensitive curves derived from the actual data. Now here, the function of wavelength is called the luminance efficiency function of the eye. This is the luminance efficiency function. Luminance efficiency function of the eye. For an arbitrary homogeneous region in an image that has an intensity as a function of wavelength color given by eye, the three responses are called as tri-stimulus values. Here, this is the tri-stimulus values. So we have for x, y and z, this is the way we will calculate I lambda, x bar lambda, a lambda. This x bar is called is the luminance efficiency function of the eye. Then we have the color models. The most important topic, that is the color models. The color model is an orderly system for creating a whole range of colors from small primary colors. There are two types of color models, basically subtracting models and the additive models. Here, two types. Additive color models use light to display color, while subtractive color models use printing inks. Additive color models use light, okay, that is RGB color model is there, and for this printing inks we have CMYK, cyan, magenta, yellow and type of system is there. So we have transmitted light and reflected light. The colors perceived in the additive models are the result of transmitted light. And what is it called? The colors perceived by the subtractive models are the results of the reflected light.